This evening on the Rock Newman Show, 2 weeks ago, Ted Leonsis, owner of the Wizards, Mystics, and Capitals, visited our show for a gripping conversation. But 1 hour just wasn't enough to cover his extraordinary life. So Ted is back to delve more into sports ownership, film production, and philanthropy. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. If you had to choose a career path in technology, sports ownership, or film production, which would you choose? Well, Ted Leonsis didn't choose just one. He chose them all, and he's here to talk about it. Ted, you're looking great, man.
Thanks, Rock. How are you?
Thank you so much for coming back. You know, before we get into sort of our script, if you will, let me step off for a second because we talked a little bit the last time you were here about your role in helping kids in D.C. be able to achieve the dream of going to college, the program you head up, CAPS. There is an announcement made today, and I want you to be aware of it. Howard University President, District of Columbia Mayor Muriel Bowser, and the District of Columbia Public Schools Chancellor Kaya Henderson announced a new dual enrollment partnership for high school students here in the District of Columbia. Take a look, you'll love this.
Beginning in the fall of 2015, eligible students from Banneker and McKinley Technical Technology High Schools can take college-level courses at Howard University and experience the academic rigor and the rewards of college life free of charge. Howard University will waive the cost of classes, and the credits students earn will be applicable to their high school record and transferable to the college of their choice. Of course, we will be delighted if that choice is Howard University.
Now imagine this. You can go to two great DC public high schools and get credits at the great Howard University. So what? Just see what that means for middle class families.
I love making that kind of announcement, man.
Dr. Frederick is a great man and very innovative, and it's good to see the city and Howard University collaborating like that. And I think it's very welcome news to help us to create a real college-going culture and environment. And what better way than to have students that are in high school be able to come and see a campus and yeah. See the rigor of study that's needed and get to see what professors are all about, and that's a great idea.
You know, Ted, I came to Howard University as a freshman in 1970, 45 years ago, and I have today what my wife has called, we've been married 31, going on 32 years, and for 32 years, she's accused me of having a juvenile loyalty to Howard University, that when I bleed, I bleed Howard Blue. When there was a search going on by the Board of Trustees for a new president, from whatever I could do from my little corner of the world, I was so passionate about hoping and urging and encouraging that they would select Dr. Frederick. He was interim president. I thought that if ever there was the right time for the right man to do a difficult job, he was the one that had all the qualifications, and perhaps as important as any of those qualifications was his absolute passion for this university. You're absolutely right about him being a great guy at the helm.
Yeah, you're absolutely right on he being the right man for the job, and leading an academic institution these days is very, very challenging. It's very hard economic times. It's it's to build the reputation and get research dollars and have selectivity scores increasing is hard. Yeah. And I've spent quality time with Dr. Frederick, and he's up to the task. And he loves the school, he loves the city, and look forward to seeing what he does here.
I think it was Monday morning, my wife came pounding on my office door. And she was like, have you heard the news? Have you heard the news? I was like, I mean, it really startled me. I was like, what? She was like, turn on the news. And I turned on, and whatever she was trying to tell me to see had gone off, but then it came back. And it was the headline, and talked about the possibility, the potential. Certainly, you know, there's a bridge, there's a long bridge to cross, but the possibility that Monumental Sports, your company, and Howard University may collaborate on a sports and training facility. As someone who I said came here in 1970 and was told that the gymnasium, Burr Gymnasium, was going to be renovated, there was going to be a new place built in a year or two. It's now been 45 years and that hasn't happened. The prospect of that collaboration for somebody who has loved this university for 45 years made me beyond giddy. What can you tell us?
Well, it's no secret that the Wizards need to build a new practice facility. It needs to be world class, and it would be great if we could have it here in Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. The city had talked to us about several potential locations for it where they had some land. And then a developer called us and said, would you consider being creative and innovative and considering Howard University? And I said, yeah, of course. That makes great sense. They're right up the street from us. Yeah. It's a community that's the next great neighborhood in the city. And I love everything I've heard about not only the university, but their new leaders. So what I'm going to do one day is on my own, I'm just going to walk the campus. Mm-hmm. And so literally in November, I came and walked the campus, and I went into the health center, and I walked around the gym, and I walked around the quad, and I had a good vibe. Mm-hmm. And so we did meet with Dr. Frederick, and there are discussions going on. As you say, there's still a lot to have accomplished, right. But I think it if we can work out terms with the city, yeah, that it could be a very, very good solution for everyone. And this campus, the community deserves it. And we would be honored to be associated with Howard University. And so I'm very open-minded. Yeah. And I usually when something leaks, yeah, I get all upset. Yeah. And I say, well, it's true, we are talking. Mm-hmm. Now, we are talking to people in Virginia, we are talking to people in Maryland, mm-hmm, and you never know what will happen, but you know, this is a great community and a great campus, and be wonderful if we could do something here.
Well, I'm sure Dr. Frederick needs no help in selling the value and the virtues of a collaboration with Howard University. As someone who came through their sports program and who has always stayed closely associated with the school, I see the potential from the Howard University side as this being a total 100% game changer. This is the kind of exciting news that could do something that would take Howard from someone who, you know, competes in the Mideastern Athletic Conference to perhaps becoming a national power in basketball. I mean, it has that kind of potential. So needless to say, we're excited.
Well, great, and you know, what's great about Howard is its focus on academics.
Yes.
But there's no reason that, I mean, we just saw Duke, which is a great school, win the national championship, and we'd love to see all the schools in the city have competitive and aspirational programs, and mm-hmm, I would think that Howard and its, where it's situated, should be the number one place that student athletes would want to matriculate. And what I will say is when you have a exciting and productive men's basketball team, it brings a national spotlight onto you, and only good things happen from there. Research institutions want to work with you, sponsors want to be involved, you'll get more applications, there'll be better students than that want to come here, and so the spiral kind of, yes, goes up, and yeah, And so as long as you don't over-index, you know, you don't want to be a football school or a basketball school. You want to be a great university that has really competitive athletic programs. And Stanford has done probably the best job of that. Yeah. I'm proud of what Georgetown has done, a great school with a great men's basketball team. And why not Howard?
Well, as you contemplate, we figured we'd do something here to, you know, as you contemplate. That's a pair of Howard University socks. And as you see, they match up the colors of the Wizards and the Capitals.
There you go. Well, thank
and
you.
And here is something to keep you warm on those morning runs, and that's a Howard University sweatshirt.
Fantastic. Well, I'll wear that with pride, and I really appreciate it very much.
Okay. Ted, if we could, I would like to go off script for a moment for what we might ordinarily talk about, you know, all of your teams and the film company and your philanthropic efforts. We saw yesterday, and I'm making an assumption that you may have seen it also, the horrific video footage of a cop in South Carolina killing a man as he was walking away. I spoke to several of my black friends, and there was a sense of outrage for seeing the video. The outrage was elevated as a result of feeling these things have happened in the past, but the perpetrators walked free because there was not evidence of the wrongdoing. From someone, and I'll say it this way, a very humble man, but you know, at your perch, one of the movers and shakers in this country, how do you, what do you feel when you see that?
Anguish and pain and just a sense of disbelief. I don't have the context of what happened before and after. I only saw the video.
Sure.
And I thought the reaction from the local authorities was absolutely correct in that they said that's murder. Yeah. There was no need to have to kill a person for a traffic violation. Right. And it's unfathomable and unacceptable on all counts to have police who are public servants who really are there to improve the quality of life in a community to take such an action. And I'm sure it pains all the good policemen, all the good people in authority and organizations, because most people want to help their community. And so an action like that just sets things back in such a bad way. And the only positive that will come out of it is people will do their gut checks again to look at, are the people that we have staffed of the right psychological bent? Have they been trained the right way? Are we harboring people that shouldn't be on the police force? But I think that wasn't a, I mean, I have tremendous empathy when you say that your black friends had that kind of experience. I can tell you that everyone had that kind of experience, that when you see something as dramatic and straightforward like that, you just can't process it as a human.
Yeah.
There was no need for that man to be shot in the back as he was walking away, running away, especially since it was a traffic violation.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and inevitably, the issue of race comes up there. White cop, you know, black suspect, white cop kills black guy. So inevitably, race comes in that. And as I sort of look at our political and social landscape here in 2015, and think of the times that I came through the latter part of the civil rights movement when there was optimism about the races coming together, I see a polarization, what too often is a polarization and a separation, and the optimism for race relations that I think I once felt seems to be subsiding. And again, I just wonder if you weigh in as to what you think and how you feel.
I actually would take a contrarian position on that. I think that young people, millennials, who are all desirous or a large portion are going to urban-based universities, Howard, Georgetown, George Washington, and then they graduate and they want to stay in urban centers. We have the most millennials in the country here in Washington, D.C. And this population has really held a mirror up to society today. And there's not the polarization amongst young people, for the most part, that are graduating from college and coming into urban centers and going into the workforce. That's why many of us are so compelled that the bridge to cross to get to that kind of normalization is education. And you know, as we've talked about, Ward 7 and Ward 8 here, some of Southeast, the graduation rates and then the ability to go to college and graduate from college is unacceptably low. And so that you get this isolation. And there is a we and them discussion. And I really think that it's all of our goals to try and get the country to be healed is a bad word, because I don't know if you can ever totally heal hundreds and hundreds of years of history, but kind of on a new platform where people are all in pursuit of the same dream. They have the same perspective, their talents, their viewpoints are appreciated. I know in next generation like businesses, we don't talk about black, white, Latino, women, men. We're totally committed to talent. And so what we find, we're finding more and more, like women-led businesses are building more value than men. Younger people are doing better in businesses than some older people. And we're trying to embrace and create a really, really big platform, selfishly, because it's good business. Whenever you have a group that's discriminated against, or you have a perception of there not being fair services offered to everyone, that's reprehensibly wrong morally, but it's also not wise for building quality of life, for being able to create thriving enterprises.
That's a looking forward, that's a sense of optimism that is really good to hear.
I think the glass is half full, and you know, every once in a while, society takes a step back. I think you see more and more people trying to rally around doing the right thing the right way. And when there's something bad that happens, teachable moments in the regard of what just happened with that police officer, I think that's a shock to the system, and I think the appropriate actions have been taken.
Okay, let's talk about, you know, when we talk about that, we talk about race, we talk about social issues, police brutality, whatever it might be. We talk about real life. It's less known about you and your having stepped into the world of film. And you have a company, SnagFilms. What inspired that, and what do you hope to do with the company?
Well, sometimes I'm disappointed in popular culture media. And I started to make movies, and I wanted to make movies under an umbrella term I called filmanthropy. Let's make movies that shine the light on a tough subject and activate conversation and charitable giving and volunteerism around the subject matter. And let's do more mission-based good work film and less Spider-Man 8. And so I made a movie and it was accepted at Sundance, and HBO ran it, won an Emmy Award, and I was very proud of the work, but I was horrified by how the industry treated filmmakers and how it curated the film. It was more about product and money and less about mission and changing the world.
What was the name of that movie?
That film was called Nanking.
Yeah.
And it was a film about a Schindler's List kind of action in time in 1937 when the Japanese invaded Nanking, which was the capital of China at the time. And it was called The Rape of Nanking, and 400,000 people were slaughtered. Mm-hmm. And I really knew nothing about this time in history. Yeah. And when I bought the book, I read a book called The Rape of Nanking. It said the forgotten Holocaust. Mm-hmm. And all I could think of was, imagine Washington, D.C., an invading army comes here, and 14,000 women are raped in a 30-day period, and 400,000 people are killed. No one knew the story.
Yeah.
And so I decided to make the movie, and I was very frustrated that our film was considered a winner, mm-hmm. but it wasn't curated well, and not enough people saw it, even though it was on HBO. Mm-hmm. So I just thought I could use the internet and the web to find a way to allow these films that got no distribution to have their day in the light. Mm-hmm. And so Snag was created, and you can go watch the movie for free on SnagFilms. Mm-hmm. And then if you like it, you can snag it. That's why it's called SnagFilms, and embed it in your Facebook page or your blog or your website, or you can pass it on via email and let other people watch it. Mm-hmm.
And do you snag it for a fee or?
No, it's free. And uh-huh. and we sell advertising around it.
Okay.
And we've gotten great scale, and then we pass on 50% of the ad revenue to the filmmaker. But what I have found, just like in the movies that I made, the money's nice and it's good and important, but it's getting the work seen, which is more important. Mm-hmm. And because most of these films are mission-based. My last film that we were fortunate ran on A&E was called Lost for Life. Uh-huh. And it dealt with young adults who were implicated in very, very tough situations and were in jail, life without parole. And we as a country have more than 2,000 young people that are serving life without parole. It's such an emotional issue. It's being debated at the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. And it was a subject I didn't know much about and did a lot of research, and a director came to me with this idea, and he was able to go into prison and talk to these young men and women. There was an African-American gentleman who at 14 years old was a gangbanger. The first time he ever shot a gun, he shot and killed somebody. It was a terrible situation. He went to jail, and he became totally redeemed. And he was eventually freed. And he's doing great work in his community, making sure that other young people don't face the same circumstances. And it was a highlight in the film, in that the film asks, could you forgive? That's the basic fundamental of the film. It talks about all of the legal issues. It explores four or five cases. And many of these children have committed some of these acts in very, very difficult circumstances. There's one case where a young man engineered the slaying of his stepfather. And he did. He killed his stepfather. But it came to light that he had been abused, and his younger brothers had been abused. And the mother, frankly, was aware of it, but couldn't get out of this relationship. And yet the young man was still sentenced to life without parole. And it's very, very moving, where all of a sudden you veer from, he should, throw the key away, to to here's a young man who killed someone who's 14 years old, and he's redeemed and forgiven, and he's very positive contributing to society. And those are the kinds of movies I like to make. They're hard to watch. They deal with real life.
Yes.
And I'm happy to say, because the price of production's going down and people growing up in this YouTube generation, everyone's going to be an independent filmmaker, and they're going to make movies about their passion or some cause-related issue. And I want Snag to be a place that filmmakers come and we will distribute their movie, and I'll continue to make movies and get them distributed and put them on Snag as well.
He's probably going to be very embarrassed that I brought up his name, but your CEO is a giant, Rick Allen.
Rick is a good man. How do you know Rick?
Rick is a big boxing fan.
He is.
And we had lunch talking about Muhammad Ali, and we've gone to lunch multiple times since then.
Well, Rick worked at National Geographic, worked in the Clinton White House, mm-hmm. and he was the founding CEO. He's doing a great job, and he is mission-based.
Yeah.
I mean, he wants this company to be able to help filmmakers raise money. Mm-hmm. He wants the company to be able to right some wrongs. I mean, when you work on a film or a piece of media that can change public perception or activate volunteerism, it's a very noble higher calling, and Rick's a good man to lead us.
Ted, you run the show, you run the ship. I'm curious as to whether or not you have any people that are involved with you that might say to you, hey man, it's a good, great, and wonderful thing for you to try to make this positive difference. But are you spending too much time trying to make this positive difference that you could be spending trying to make a more positive difference in growing the revenue? Do you ever get that? Do you ever get any pushback?
Yeah, on occasion I think you could be criticized, and it is something that some people in Silicon Valley think.
Mm-hmm.
You'll hear them say, I'm going to work really hard, make a lot of money, and then when I retire at the end of my life, then I'll give it all back.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, well, that's your perspective, and that's maybe right for you. But it's not just money that is needed. Many times it's mentoring, it's counseling, it's getting involved, and what I have found is that when I get involved with a charity, the more I get involved with mentoring, then the more money I'll give, right? Because then you get a personal connection and you can see the ultimate positive outcome of the work.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think there's a lot of money around to do good. And I'd say many foundations, you know, we talked about DC College Success, and frankly, the Gates Foundation gave, I think, $150 million
right.
to it. We have
mm-hmm.
enough money to fund the scholarships.
Mm-hmm.
It's finding students and households that will encourage their child to want to go to college and stay in college and fight through all of the issues around their circumstances to realize that when they graduate from college, they can come back and do well. And so I want to do it now. I don't want to wait till I'm dead to try to give back.
If I was in church, I'd say hallelujah. Hey, let's switch gears. Tonight, the Capitals, the Wizards, and the Nationals are playing. It's a three-peat in D.C. You own two of those teams. You own the Capitals and you own the Wizards. What drew you to become a team owner? What was your motivation?
Well, growing up, sports played such a big part of my life. As I said, both my mom and dad worked and took subways home and would get home at 7 o'clock at night, and I'd get out of school at 3. And there was 4 hours where you weren't in the home,
mm-hmm.
you were playing ball.
Mm-hmm.
And I just saw how important sports were and teamwork, and building your sense of teamwork and collaboration, but also heightening your competitiveness. And then when...
Did you have an idol?
Well, I grew up in New York, and so, you know, the old Knicks teams, I thought were pretty good. The, like Willis Reed and Walt Frazier, and that team was pretty special. I got to go to some hockey games as a kid. My dad was a waiter, and he had a customer who on occasion would slip him tickets. Mm-hmm. When I came to Georgetown, there were it was $5. You'd get on a bus, and you'd go out to Capital Center. It was the ticket, a hot dog, and a Coke.
Yeah.
And so I always loved sports, and then when I was approached with the opportunity to buy the Capitals and then a piece of the Wizards, and with the opportunity to buy the rest of the Wizards in Verizon Center at some point in the future, I was scared because it's such a big social responsibility, but my wife convinced me that it was the right thing to do and that it would be another way to give back to the community. Mm-hmm. And it, I could exercise both parts of my personality in that, hey, let's go try to win some championships, let's make the playoffs, let's build the best team. We're better in New York, we're better in Philly, we're better in Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm. You know, let's go, go, go. And at the same time, I think sports and the players, they become such role models.
Yeah.
And you can get your season ticket holders and your sponsors to activate around charities. And so, you know, I took the risk. I jumped in. This is the first year since I've owned both teams, and both teams have made the playoffs at the same time. Mm-hmm. I'm thrilled for the community.
And I want to talk about that. I want to talk about today, tonight, and going forward. But I'd like to walk you back for a moment. The first name that came out of your mouth when I asked you if you had a hero, you said, I watched the Knicks, and the first name that came out was Willis Reed. So what I'd like for you to do, we've got viewers in here who might not have ever heard the name Willis Reed. I'd like if you would take us back to, I'm just going to call it, the game.
Well, Willis Reed was the captain of the of the Knicks. He was an undersized forward slash center, left-handed. He was really tough. Mm-hmm. There was one game where he took on the whole bench, the entire team. You go to YouTube and type in Willis Reed versus the Lakers. Yeah. And during the playoffs, he was injured. Mm-hmm. And it looked like the Lakers would be able to beat the Knicks and win the championship. And in the game that he wasn't supposed to play, during the warm-ups, he kind of limped out.
And Ted Leonsis was where and feeling how?
I was watching on television, and I was screaming and jumping, and he hit his first couple of shots, and he didn't play that much.
It lit that arena, Madison
it
Square.
It was, and everyone in the community was going out of their mind. You know, the Lakers had a great team, Jerry West,
yeah,
and Wilt Chamberlain,
yes,
and the Knicks won, and it was great. It was like an underdog story, and it was someone overcoming great adversity. It was a lot of fun. We have that here with Wes Unseld, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, Wes Unseld was 6'7", 6'8", undersized. He was MVP and Rookie of the Year his first year in the Hall of Fame. And so I've always, probably just because of my background, I've always liked underdogs. I've always liked when somebody says, you can't do it. If you want me to not do something, don't tell me you can't do it.
Yeah.
Just the opposite will happen. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, yeah, that team was very, very special.
So what you just talked about there was sort of your competitiveness. You said if you say don't, if you don't want you to do it, don't say you can't do it. Yeah. So what's it going to take for the Capitals and the Wizards? Hey, let's be greedy here. We want the championship in with both squads.
I would say that there's some magic in good planning around winning a championship. When I say magic, you can have a really, really good team, and you can suffer an injury at the wrong time. And the playoffs are such a grind. And so health really, really matters. Luck, sometimes, you know, fortune shines on those who are most prepared, but luck has a lot to do with it. You'll see in hockey sometimes, games going in overtime and you hit the post and it bounces out and then you don't score and someone then scores afterwards. And you know, you look at the replay and the puck was this much from going in. And so luck has a lot to do with it. And then you have third parties, refereeing. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people after the Duke game the other day. Duke fans say too many fouls on our star players in the first half. And then Wisconsin fans say way too many fouls in the second half against our guys. And it's a very, very tough job being an official, but they play a big role. And then you have the whole chemistry, being able to have people sacrifice. Most teams that win championships are more about we than I. Mm-hmm. And the NBA, you have this star system, and to get stars to collaborate, if you will. We're blessed with John Wall. We've got our star player defines himself by making other players better.
I was going to ask you about Wall and Beal, that backcourt.
We're going to have a good backcourt for a long, long time, and we're very, very committed to continuing to build around them, just as we've done with Alex Ovechkin. And you know, the first step is you got to make the playoffs, and half the league doesn't make the playoffs every year. And you know, we're criticized at the Wizards, and you know, I think appropriately so. But the team made the playoffs four times, and then we've made it 2 years in a row. And I think over the last dozen years or so, that's the fifth most time in the East. Well, there's 15 teams in the East. That means we've done better in at least making the playoffs. Mm-hmm. Now, we won the first round last year, and obviously we want to go deeper this year. And you know, we won't stop until we have a team that we think can win a championship. And then it all comes down to timing and luck and good fortune and health and that one big play. You know, Miami won a championship, and there was one play. You know, Chris Bosh gets a great rebound, throws it to Ray Allen. Ray Allen takes the step back, hits the three. Yeah. They win that game. Mm-hmm. Their fans were leaving the room. Mm-hmm. And so making the big play at the right time is also vital to win a championship.
Can you share with our viewers here the experience of owning a team, paying a guy, and I'm speaking now of Gilbert Arenas, paying him what in the NBA parlance is the max out contract, I forget, $126 million, whatever it might have been. And his time with the team being short-lived, and he, along with someone else, I even forget the guy who he had the altercation with, bringing guns into the stadium. How, as an owner, did you process that, and what kind of conversation you had with the player or his agent?
Well, the timing of the event happened before I bought the team. And Gilbert was a great player and was frankly beloved in the community. And then he brought guns into the locker room, and that's illegal.
Yeah.
And it's against every rule in the league, and it's also, as you know, a federal offense here in Washington, D.C. And so the league suspended him. And during that time, Mr. Poland passed away. So it was a very, very difficult time for the organization. And then I bought the franchise and came back in to lead in ownership. And then Gilbert came back to play the same year that we drafted John Wall. And it was a very tough situation for everyone involved. Gilbert had been suspended, had missed the season, basically, and came back. He had some injuries, and he wasn't in a positive frame of mind. And to be direct, he traded himself. He worked really, really hard with his agent and his people and ended up going to Orlando for a fresh start. It didn't work so well in Orlando. He then went to Memphis, and he went to China. I've certainly lost touch with him.
Yeah.
It's a shame, though, because Gilbert was a good man and a really good player, and that one joke, if you will, that one thing that got out of hand really had a negative effect on the fan base, on him and his career, on the franchise, and obviously he wishes, and we all wish that didn't happen.
Let me ask you a question. Collective bargaining agreement give the NBA players very, very, guaranteed contracts. Did his money get compromised as a result of that behavior?
I'll be honest, I'm not sure what happened when he got suspended, where mm-hmm. those dollars went. The leagues and the unions work very, very hard to create programs and systems that are fair and, both teams, both sides believe in. Mm-hmm. And then every once in a while, there's an event that you didn't plan for, you didn't think. Mm-hmm. Bringing guns into the locker room and is just not something that you're scripted for. And I thought, in hindsight, when I looked at the organizations, did the right thing the right way. Mm-hmm. But it was just one of those situations that clearly everyone wished hadn't happened.
We talked about an incident that just happened in South Carolina with the police officer and the authorities there acting swiftly and seemingly correctly. Sort of one of the NBA ownership brethren, Donald Sterling, had his craziness to take place and to utter some just despicable terms. Adam Silver, who had just taken over as commissioner of the NBA, moved very swiftly. Can you take us back to that time and what sort of the brethren, what you all were talking about?
Well, again, it was a tough to process time. just the and I know Magic Johnson. I mean, so that was doubly painful. Mm-hmm. I love Magic Johnson. Mm-hmm. Magic Johnson is a class act. Yeah. He is the greatest human being you could meet.
Yeah.
Magic Johnson comes to DC Cap events. He donated $50,000 on the spot for scholarships the other day. I mean, he's just a great, great person. And so the combination of having an owner say what he said and then have it involve Magic Johnson was doubly painful for everybody. And so Adam Silver was brand new commissioner to being with the league for a long time. He didn't ask our counsel. And so there was this press conference, and mm-hmm. he stood up, and I think to a person, we were all proud of him. I think that he was decisive and direct, and he did exactly the right thing for the league. He acted like
he did not lead from behind. He didn't ask for you guys' counsel.
Nope. And his instincts were correct, and we all have his back. And I'm very, very proud of him, and I'm very proud of the league. And, we try to lead in the NBA in being a team and group that celebrates diversity. And again, it's the right thing to do when you have this big social responsibility and this big platform. Mm-hmm. It also makes a lot of sense considering that the NBA is a league that's populated by some of the greatest athletes ever and in the world, and many of them are African American.
Yeah.
And so it just made common sense, mm-hmm. and it was also the right thing to do. And so I'm proud of our commissioner.
And then the team gets sold for $2 billion, which grows the value of other teams.
Yeah, I mean that was purely because of the market. Mm-hmm. LA is a market, and owning sports teams, people I don't think realize, for the most part, sports teams are not profitable. It's not a here today kind of business. Mm-hmm. It's a business on the exit. If mm-hmm. you sell the business, mm-hmm. that if someone aspires to own that team, you'll make a lot of money.
Yeah, so you buy in at $10, you hold on for a while, you hold on and you lose sometimes,
yeah,
year after year, but the value increases and your exit is when you cash in.
Exactly, and you know, for many people, that's when they pass away, right? And so for me, I look at the teams more as a way to exercise the competitiveness, give back to the community. I mean, I really want to win a championship. Mm-hmm. I think that would be to create lifelong memories between mothers and fathers and friends and daughters and mothers and family members, and say I was there when they won that championship, and to participate in some kind of parade where everyone is outside and they capture that moment. Abe and Irene Poland were able to do that once in 1978, yeah. And you know, we want to do that again for the Wizards. And so the dollars and cents long term will take care of themselves, mm-hmm. But short term, these are not great businesses.
Mm-hmm. We've talked about the Wizards. Let's talk a little bit about the Caps, who, again, both teams are looking to yep. play in the playoffs. First, you know, you say Caps, you think of number 8.
Well, we're living in a special time. We're seeing a historic player. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes the media, they take excellence for granted. Mm-hmm. You know, Alex scored his 50th goal. I think he has 52 goals.
And for any of us who might not know who number 8 is, we're talking about
Alex
Ovechkin.
Right. And only 6 other players in the history of the game, the game's mm-hmm. over 100 years old, had accomplished what he'd accomplished.
Yeah.
And I liken him a little bit to a LeBron James-like player. He's got great personality, great leadership capability. He leads the league in goals. He's top scorer. He leads the league in hits. He's our captain. He's charismatic. He gives back to the community. And it's a joy to watch. And everything about him is unique. When he's skating, he sounds different. Mm-hmm. You'll hear when commentators are talking about a great golfer like Tiger Woods that on the practice range, when they hit the ball, yeah. it sounds different, yeah. a really great hitter. And it's really true. Mm-hmm. When Alex's release, Alex's shot, it's so hard, so different. And so it's a historic player, and our fans realize it. You don't know what you're going to see. Yeah. Game by game with yeah. him, and just that expectation. Now, we have to have a great team, and what's missing on his resume is a championship.
Yes.
And until we win a Stanley Cup, his resume is incomplete. Mm-hmm. And I feel it's incumbent on me. I feel probably the pressure of him not winning a Stanley Cup as much or as more than he does, mm-hmm. because I know that I'm blessed to have a player who wants to be in the community, yeah. loves the Capitals, has done so much for us, and we haven't won a championship yet.
He is arguably, I heard it on a talk show the other day, they were debating about who the greatest athlete in Washington, D.C. sports history is. And with his accomplishments now, just to date, he absolutely has to be in that debate.
Yeah, I frankly think there is no debate. I think he's the greatest athlete locally of our generation. Mm-hmm. He's won 3 MVPs.
Yeah, yeah.
He should win the MVP
year. We're talking about all
yeah, it's
time.
A historic performance is what we witness.
Let me ask you this. In hockey, there are no rules that I know of which allow hockey players to punch each other in the face?
Well, there's no rules, but there's really true etiquette and culture about fighting. And fighting is moving out of the game. Mm-hmm. But for instance, you never just fight. You ask the person, do you want to go?
And so this is real. I mean,
this is real. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and lightweights fight lightweights, mm-hmm. and heavyweights fight heavyweights.
Okay.
And you know, on occasion, what you'll see is players are policing to make sure when a ref misses something. So if there's an inadvertent elbow thrown at a player of skill by a tough guy, that player needs to know that he's going to answer for that. And if he answers for it, it'll make him less prone to do that. And there's a culture and an etiquette, and it works. Mm-hmm. If you one of the things I'm concerned about, if they took fighting totally out of the game, then you might have a little bit more rogue activity, because there'd be no price to pay other than, you know, a 2-minute penalty. Mm-hmm. And so the system's been good. There is less and less fighting. There's much more emphasis on speed. The game has evolved. And another thing about hockey, why it's such a great game, football, America's sport, there's like 12 minutes of actual action in that entire 3-hour production.
Yeah.
You know, it's running play, or someone runs out of bounds. Mm-hmm. Hockey, you're moving at speed for every moment, and you can't run out of bounds. You run into a wall and glass. Mm-hmm. There's very little timeouts in hockey. So it's a great game. And there's a recent article in the Washington Post about indoor sports, basketball being one. The average age of a basketball fan is 37 years old. Hockey, it's a little bit older, but not too much older, and they've become global sports. And baseball, the average age is 54 years old. You know, baseball needs to do a better job in speeding the game up. We live in this real-time world. We're tweeting right away. We're posting on Instagram our photos right away. A 9-inning game in a 4-hour setting is a tough and a big commitment of time for a young generation. And we're very fortunate that basketball and hockey lend themselves to this real-time, multimedia world. They sometimes feel like video games come to life.
What's next for Ted Leonsis?
Well, you know, it's funny you ask, because my wife was asking me the other day, you were so committed and working so hard on the Olympics, and then that just ended. It came to an immediate end.
Yeah.
And like 2 weeks later, I agreed to jump into doing the DC CAP work and scholarship work. We just had a great event at the Kennedy Center, raised a lot of money, and I think I just have to keep moving forward. I don't ever want to just sit around and think about things. I want to have a quiet mind and a high level of activity. And so right now the thing I think I want to focus on most is what do we as a community have to do to rally around a couple of big things end to end to solve? And when I was a kid, I used to like to wash my car. And the reason I liked to wash my car is something was dirty, and then I could like clean it and expend energy and then look and go, that looks great. I'm proud of my activity, and I see payback in the work. And you know, I'd like to see, can we help to fix and work with Kaya Henderson and our mayor and help the educational system? That would be like a big deliverable. What do we have to do to eradicate homelessness? I mean, there's no reason that our city, our community can't find jobs, can't find housing, can't find affordable housing. And that's something that, you know, we should say we can end that or put like a huge dent into it so that it's not a chronic issue. And so I'll try to find a couple of big things to work on where I can rally government and business and people and try to bring them together to fix some problems, and that'll occupy my free time, and the rest of my time will be with my family and obviously the teams.
Do you see anybody in the family following in your sports ownership footsteps?
I'm blessed. I've been married 28 years, mm-hmm. and we have a son and a daughter, and my son Zach is graduating from Georgetown Business School. He went to Penn undergrad. He'll come back into the business, and he loves the teams. He knows all my partners, and I'm sure he'll have a positive impact. We've already discussed what charity should he get mm-hmm. active in. He's expressed some political aspiration, so I'm proud of him that he wants to be involved in the community. My daughter graduated from Georgetown, and she wants to be a filmmaker, a documentary filmmaker, mm-hmm. and has worked and interned at SnagFilms, and she wants to help change the world through positive media. So, it's the greatest accomplishment. The greatest thing I can hear is when somebody says, "Oh, I met your son, and boy, he's a really nice guy."
My compliment for you, man, you are a great dude. Thank you very much for joining us today. Thanks for the opportunity. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you, and I'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.